President Jones, Dean Fraden, thank you for that very, very generous introduction. Thanks also to all of you for coming out this afternoon. Many of you have traveled from far away, indeed some of you from very far away, to be here today. But all of you have committed a block of that most scarce resource, your time, to come to this talk, and I'm very appreciative. I'd also like to thank a number of people who have been essential to the... also like to thank a number of people who have been essential to the progress in the research I'm going to be talking about this afternoon. Two blocks from Trinity is the Olin Neuropsychiatry Research Center, a preeminent facility for brain science. I've greatly benefited from Olin researchers, including Vince Calhoun, Godfrey Pearlson, Robert Astor, and others. But one of the many amazing benefits of the proximity to this center has been the opportunities it's provided for our students who have pursued independent research projects under the sponsorship and directorship of Olin researchers. I will be talking about the work of two of them today, Kara Carvalho and Abby Garrity. Kara is on the left in that picture. And you'll see that the projects that they undertook as undergraduates have borne fruit in very interesting ways. Those projects were both begun in their sophomore years when they were enrolled in the program Tutorial College at Trinity. I also want to thank my friends and colleagues here in the village. You've been very supportive of a very independent interdisciplinary research program over the years. I'm greatly appreciative of that. And Rihanna, Morgan, and Cheryl, thank you for being you. To begin, like all my colleagues here at Trinity, as a teacher and scholar, it is my obligation to pursue and keep up with all of the leading journals in my field and all of the most recent findings, including journals like this one, Heaven photographed by a Hubble telescope. Just between us, I think they may have made this up. But suppose it weren't, they didn't. Suppose that this were true. Imagine the kinds of questions that the theologian Bishop Brownell might be pondering in the light of Hubble Heaven. Questions like, is Hubble Heaven the same as biblical heaven? Are the streets really paved with gold? And perhaps most importantly, how do you get there? Well, this is fictive and fanciful, but if the Weekly World News had been a little more alert, they might have picked up this story, Thoughts Photographed by Brain Scanner, and this is not such a stretch. Everyone in this room, I think, is fully aware that we are currently surfing on a crest of a tremendous wave of brain science. These are just some of the headlines culled from popular press, in some cases hyping and overhyping research results in this field. A lot of this new science depends on the ability to take pictures of the functioning living brain. These particular articles and the pictures that streamed by are made with functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI. I'll be talking about fMRI in its what I will call its classical approach. That's something of an oversimplification and a caricature, but in order to characterize a large body of this huge and explosive area of research, I will refer to a so-called classical approach here. I welcome the parade. I welcome the wave of research. It's fascinating. It keeps on coming. But I'm also going to suggest today that there's a kind of tunnel vision there, that the research, again, in its caricaturized classical version, is in some ways a limitation on what might be seen using this very technology of fMRI. So I'm going to direct the talk towards a couple of different themes. First is I'll suggest, after I review with you a little bit of how the so-called classical approach works, that there is a need for new experiments, that there's a need for new methods of data analysis, and finally, that there is a need or an opportunity for new methods of presenting or exploring or otherwise visualizing or even hearing data. The first two of these new departures are very much in the air at the Olin Center and other places. Olin has been pioneering these, but the other, I think, is novel, and you might be hearing a bit about it here first. fMRI. This is a typical fMRI research setup. And so how many of you have been scanned for one reason or another, been inside one of these? It's becoming increasingly a part of our lives. So most of us can compare notes and maybe show snapshot wall pictures of our scans. But what you may not have seen is what comes off the scanner in the form of what we might call the raw scanner signal. This is a movie, it's greatly speeded up in order, just so that we can get through it, of a brain in the scanner. What we're seeing here is not anatomy, but function. Run by this again. And we're actually looking at the brain from about the ears back. So it's the back half of the head. And these are slices. The images are collected one slice at a time, very rapidly, and what I've done is speed up their presentation. What we notice about a movie like this is that the activity that we're picking up in the so-called raw image is everywhere. It's global, it's all over the brain, and that it's all moving all the time, that it's dynamic, that it's seething and continuous at all times. And this is what fMRI signals look like no matter what the experiment is, and no matter who the subject is. So, here on the other hand is a picture from a publication from the Journal of Cognitive Neuroscience, and a wonderful paper by Alwyn Ishai. She was looking at how the brain represents objects that are quite familiar to us, houses, faces, and chairs, and among other figures, this is one of them. And as is the case with much of this research, you see that discrete areas in the brain are identified as related to the perception, say, of faces. They're discrete, and these images are static. And this, of course, is typical of this literature. Here's the raw image again. Here's the processed image. As it happens, the movie I showed you is Ishai's data. It's publicly archived, and you can work with it yourself. And it began looking like the movie. And it ended up in publication looking like the thing on top. What I call the classical method is the path from the one to the other, from the raw image to the final presentation. And so now I'm going to take you on a very compressed and, again, oversimplified tour of the standard method. First thing you do is take a lot of the pictures of the brain. These, again, are functional images. They're actually recording the blood flow or the percentage of oxygenated versus deoxygenated blood. So they're responsive to metabolism and therefore indirectly linked to neural activity. So let's suppose hypothetically that we're interested in how the brain represents faces, what face perception, how that works in the brain. You might think that what you do is put someone in the scanner and throw a bunch of faces at them and record the result, and that would give you the answer. But what it gives you is something like the movie. It's nothing that is easily interpreted just looking at it in that way. So what the method does is somewhat different from that. Instead of showing only faces the whole time, the method will take the span of the experiment, which might be minutes to hours, and we'll divide the time up into blocks. For some of the time in there, the subject in the experiment will be looking at faces. But for some of the time in there, the subject will be looking at something else, a baseline condition which might, as it was in this case, be blobs of light and dark that bear no resemblance to faces. We collect a lot of each of these different kinds of images over time. This is called sometimes a block design. So the stimuli appear in blocks of time. There are other variations, other kinds of experimental design, but the underlying logic is quite similar in many cases. After we have these images, many gigabytes of data, we begin to condense them. And the first step of this is often to take all the images that were collected in the one condition, the task condition, looking at faces, and average them. They are, after all, just numbers. And so we perform the arithmetic average, and you get a single image out, which is the average of activity over the period of time that the subject was looking at faces. And then, again, to do the same thing for the baseline. All of those images that are subjects looking at something else, they're averaged together. Now we have two images, an average image, a baseline image, and they both still continue to look like all-over activity. The dynamic has disappeared, but the all-overness has not. But then the